Penguin Random House Audio presents Hard Landings, Looking into the Future for a Child with Autism. This is the author, Cammie McGovern. For Ethan, of course. Also for Mike, Charlie, and Henry. Introduction. Here's what it's like in the early days after your three-year-old child is diagnosed with autism. You never sleep. You spend endless late nights in front of a computer investigating therapies that are only supported by anecdotal evidence, doctors tell you, but there's nothing else to go on. No double-blind studies, no experts who can say authoritatively, do this, it's been proven effective. The only recommendation that's truly agreed on is that early intervention is essential. The younger your child is when you start and the more hours you put in, the better the projected outcome. This means you spend years alone at home with your atypical toddler, then preschooler, then grade schooler, teaching him the basics of being a child, how to talk, how to play, how to learn, all with the nebulous goal that at some point in the future, he'll re-enter the world with some ability to participate in it. In the midst of it, you try to remember what normal feels like. You imagine what the world will look like when you return. Eventually, it happens. You venture forth again. The goals shift from completing a task at home to one in the community, because if your child has autism, the goals must eventually involve other people. He'll ask two questions of his peers. He'll order food at a restaurant. He'll participate in beginner band at school. It's hard to describe how vulnerable you feel when you watch your child try and fail at such simple undertakings. At first, you can't bear it. Let's skip that goal, you think. Let's try an easier one where he doesn't look so different. In other words, let's put off this business of rejoining the world and go back home to the privacy we've lived in for too long already. Consciously or unconsciously, I made that choice for years, or else I made half-hearted efforts. I called one summer day camp and one children's chorus to see if they'd be willing to accommodate Ethan. When the answer was no, they didn't have trained staff, they worried about overtaxing counselors, I thanked them and hung up. Fair enough, I thought, internalizing the broader message. My child is extra work and I probably shouldn't ask. Here's the thing, though. You have to ask. You can't stay home all the time and you can't make up reasons why everything he wants to do isn't possible for him. You see it more clearly with every passing year. He's not a child anymore. He's a teenager, and then he's not even a teenager anymore. He's a young adult. He wants to participate in the world. He wants a job. He wants to walk into town by himself. He wants the same friendships and relationships he sees on TV. Your child wants a life, and it's terrifying. Chapter 1. Joseph Heller coined the term Catch-22 to describe a military conundrum, a terrified fighter pilot seeking a discharge from armed services on grounds of insanity is declared sane enough to recognize the danger he faces and therefore must keep fighting. The phrase has come to symbolize the absurd vicissitudes of institutional logic and is extraordinarily apt for the generation of young adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities, IDD, coming of age in America today. For Heller, the number 22 was arbitrary. For these young adults, it isn't. 22 is the age when they'll leave their school system and lose access to every educational and vocational support they've had since they were 3 years old. In many states, their 22nd birthday will mark the last day they have anywhere to go. For 19 years, they've been part of a system designed primarily around the philosophy of inclusion. They've participated in classes and school choruses. They've gone on field trips. They've learned how to comport themselves in a community that they will soon discover has no place for them. The catch is this. They've trained for a life they can't have. They've learned skills for jobs that don't exist or they'll never get. They've practiced independent living, but they'll never live alone. Parents describe this moment as falling off a cliff without even realizing the worst part. Their kids aren't really falling because they aren't going anywhere. They're sitting in their parents' house, waiting indefinitely. Every parent of an autistic child can tell you something about making lists. In the early days after Ethan's diagnosis at the age of 3, I made them compulsively. Words he understands, words he uses regularly, only a handful at that point. Songs he can sing at least part of. I also had lists of goals composed in bursts of optimism for what he'd be doing soon. 6 months from now, he will count to 20, follow two-step directions, tell a stranger his name. At the time, I believed these lists kept us focused with our eyes on the prize that I made our number one parent goal on Ethan's first preschool IEP, or Individualized Education Plan, to enter kindergarten without an autism diagnosis. That was my thinking during our early years in the autism trenches before we'd learned how complicated and naughty the battles could get. Ethan was diagnosed just after his 3rd birthday by a gruff doctor with a thick accent we had a hard time understanding. At the start of our appointment, we'd tried to put his developmental delays in the context of a larger picture of medical issues. He'd always been a colicky infant, so prone to sinus and ear infections he seemed to wean straight from the breast onto amoxicillin. He'd had food allergies, terrible eczema, and for the last year and a half, diarrhea so severe we'd never bothered to start potty training. "Yes, this is autism," said the doctor, who seemed to be missing a few social skills himself. "The first thing you must do is lower your expectations. Don't assume he'll get a job. Hope that he can do a few things independently. Get dressed, feed himself, things like that." I was outraged, of course. Ethan was 3 years old, and this doctor was already outlining his limited future? My fury dissipated after I did some research and discovered that over half the children diagnosed with autism had experienced chronic ear infections and gastrointestinal issues. The more I read, the more this diagnosis seemed less like a tragic pronouncement on Ethan's future than a thrilling explanation for the constellation of GI problems he'd had all his life. Here at last was a connection, and with it a ray of hope. There were diets to try, therapies to get started on, children like him who were improving physically and catching up on missed developmental milestones. I read every story I could find of an autistic toddler who'd recovered completely. The nonverbal 4-year-old who went from lining up cars to reading Harry Potter. The teenager who'd left his diagnosis behind and now had a girlfriend in a software design company. In these stories, parents described the extraordinary effort required and made it clear. This wasn't an undertaking for the faint of heart. These children will resist being drawn out of their shells. They'll turn over tables and try to hurt themselves. They were right, I learned, and my heart broke as I watched Ethan resist, sometimes sobbing for hours, much of what we were trying to do. In the beginning, I often returned to those stories of cured children. I needed them because suddenly I had a full-time job I'd never applied for or wanted. I baked every night with the grains that would not aggravate his immune system. I lined up play dates, joined support groups, made flashcards and posted them around the house to surround him with language and manageable doses. I played on the floor until my knees ached, teaching Ethan the rudiments of pretend play. Should we make this banana a phone or a car? Early on, I'd learned to ask a question with choices buried in it, so an answer was right there for him to grab. I narrated his world as he encountered it, and I stopped thinking entirely about how I looked, because what did that matter when there was a child to be saved and this was what it took? My notes from those early years after Ethan's diagnosis speak volumes to my relentless optimism. In one list, I detail goals for the next 6 months. Identify 4 parts of the body. Identify 4 items of clothing. Name a friend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.